winter in the northern hemisphere, getting very cold in certain parts of the world, here in New York, into the 20s Fahrenheit, which is around -7 Celsius. And all of this is going to be from my personal observation and speculation, as there really isn't that much research available on this. Before we get started, if you guys could please sign up on frank-stefano.com to stay in touch, and be sure to subscribe so that YouTube can unsubscribe you next week. And I don't think they like that joke because they took away 100 subscribers last week. We'll see how long that goes for. One interesting thing I've thought about for a while, but haven't really had an opportunity to talk about it, is the height difference in different countries and how that pertains to climate. You have two fairly cold climates, say the Netherlands versus Alaska, but the Dutch average far taller than the First Nation Alaskans, likely because the Arctic is that much colder and has more stress on the body. Then you have the Maasai, for instance, the Nuers, various North African tribes that also grew very tall like the Dutch, despite consuming far less calories in a far different climate. So it's certain that a cold climate stresses the body calorically. It just depends if the environment and diet available are able to mitigate that efficiently. And in the Netherlands during the summer, it's tough to say. There's a lot of dietary and environmental factors at play, but we do know that the conditions for the Dutch compared to the Alaskans are more conducive and less stressful on the body for development and survival. So our number one tip is to consume cooked food. And I put hot food here, but what I really mean is calorically dense heated foods. And this can kind of overlap everything else we talk about. Generally speaking, just by having the proper meal, you can warm yourself up. The main components in this that are warming you are possibly the physical temperature of the meal and the feeding of your gut bacteria. I've noticed that raw meat, raw primal diets actually make me cold even in the summer when you don't have that cooked food in your diet. So there are definitely elements lacking, whether it's the caloric availability of the food or simply the lack of carbohydrates and fiber to feed the gut microbiome properly. Even when consuming fruits or sugar, they don't seem to have the warming effects of cooked starches. And I do believe that's because of the caloric density as well as the type of fiber in the food. A great example of a meal is what I've been doing lately: beef, venison, rabbit stew with barley, onions, mushrooms, beef broth, and some fat added to it. That will cover all your bases, giving your body protein, fat, carbohydrates to fuel both its metabolic needs, what the cells are using, as well as the gut microbiome. Imagine your gut bacteria as a living thing, just like a dog or something. And, lying next to your dog on a cold night is one way to stay warm. The reason your dog is probably warmer than you is because it's still eating a somewhat natural diet and is far healthier than a human in the context of everything. Same thing with the microbiome. That bacteria is actually producing heat, as well as the cells in your body producing heat. Granted, everything is what it should be. Number two, make sure you get adequate sleep. And there are so many problems that can go wrong in your body from not sleeping, being cold, just one of them on that long list. There are very few studies of what occurs in our bodies at the cellular level during insomnia and sleep deprivation, but the assumption is that your hormones are all messed up, there's a lack of melatonin, circadian rhythm is off, adrenaline and cortisol are through the roof, and there's also probably a substantial amount of tension in your head being caused by oxidative stress, which is going to make it even harder to sleep properly. I've observed this myself several times. One was in early 2018 when I auditioned for MasterChef in LA. I think it was like 75, 80 degrees, and I was on 10 days of no sleep in a hotel room, wasn't eating much. I was so cold that I turned the heat in the hotel room up to like 85. I was under the covers and I was still shivering. I had to go in the shower, basically turn it as hot as possible for like 15, 20 minutes, and that finally warmed me up. Third, we have nutrient deficiencies, especially iodine. Many people with thyroid issues are actually just lacking iodine, as our modern world is polluted with many halogens, the elements in the halogen family being chlorine, bromide, fluoride, and iodine. But those other elements, which are toxic to the body, replace the iodine. And if you still have them present and you're not getting enough iodine, the thyroid function is disrupted. Since iodine plays such a large role in this gland that produces hormones to regulate heat metabolism, it's a nutrient at the top of the list for staying warm. And I've had several clients who, upon taking iodine, increase their basal body temperature to a normal 98.6, whereas in the past, they were always lower. And that was actually the case for myself as well before I consistently supplemented iodine. You know, most of my life, my body temperature has been around 97. But when I started using iodine consistently, it went up to 98.6, and it stayed there as long as the iodine dosage was adequate. Of course, there are plenty of other nutrients that play large roles in hormone metabolism, and I do have several videos talking about minerals, vitamin synergy that you can go back and watch. I don't know if it's just an American thing and they're so stupid from all the fluoride in the water, but we really don't know how to dress for the cold here. And I taught this to myself in my early 20s, you know, how to layer your clothes, wearing 2 to 3 pairs of socks, having proper winter boots, long johns, and multiple layers under your jacket. I'll wear 3-4 layers before putting on my winter jacket, which actually makes me warmer without my coat than most people with everything on. It's kind of funny because I'll be outside shoveling snow with 4 layers on, but it looks like I'm wearing something like this, and my parents are telling me to wear a coat, yet they're sitting there freezing their, you know, balls off because all they're wearing is like a thin pair of jeans with nothing underneath and a winter jacket over a sweatshirt. You know, I cringe when I see the average person wearing those sneakers and jeans when it's 10 degrees outside because I know how cold I used to be in that clothing. And most people just need to buy some warm socks, a few pairs of long johns. If that doesn't keep you warm, some winter boots with like fur lining on the inside really, really help. When it's really cold, there's these things called hot hand warmers that I've used. And sometimes I do sleep with a low EMF electric blanket that I'll put both of those on my Amazon shop. I actually have the hand warmers here. By no means am I sponsored by these guys, but since my car doesn't have heat, and at Frankie's Strange Meat, you know, I'm in a freezer a lot of the day. These have helped a lot. So in these packets is like this bag full of some type of ferrous material that gets really, really hot. So once you open this up after about like 10 minutes, it gets really warm. And these have kind of saved me on a few occasions. Lastly, we have hot cold therapy. And I'm really referring to the cold therapy part, the ice baths, the cold showers. And I've tried this in the past, but I haven't been consistent enough. Usually in the summer, I would try to take cold showers to get my body used to the temperature, but I usually don't have the patience because, you know, it takes 10-15 minutes just to get your body adjusted to the cold shower comfortably. You know, normally I only spend a few minutes in the shower. There's a type of fat your body produces called brown fat, which a normal healthy person that's exposed to the cold frequently has plenty of. It allows the body to burn extra calories to keep warm. So the fat is more efficient at using up energy, but that means less resources for other bodily functions. Probably a good explanation as to why, you know, the First Nation Alaskans weren't as tall as the Dutch. Their bodies required more brown fat to stay warm, and therefore they had less calories to physically grow. And, you know, there's no point in being, you know, this gigantic, tall, 7-foot person if there's not enough food in the environment to keep you warm. Now, so hopefully this helps some of you guys out. If there's any video topics you guys would like me to talk about, please let me know. As I said earlier, if you could please sign up for the newsletter on franktestfile.com, subscribe, leave a comment down below, drop a like on the video, and I'll see you guys for tomorrow.